Hey everybody, welcome to the results from typing assignment number 10. And I'm excited about this one. We have some new participants this time, which is exciting always. And as you might recall, typing assignment 10 was an open assignment. You could write whatever you wanted. And then we had a wide variety of interesting pieces. We gave about an extra week or so for this assignment. And I think going forward, we're going to continue on that schedule. It seems like it's going to work out for a lot of people to give them a little bit more time to get their assignments done. And especially this part of the year coming up with the holiday seasons, people might be a little more busy. Okay, let's take a look at the slideshow for typing assignment 10.
Thank you.
Okay, so Diane Mayer's piece was written on a 1901 Smith Premier No. 4. And what's interesting about her piece, what I love so much about it was a quick start guide for using that very typewriter. And what's interesting about this typewriter, not only the age, but the fact that it's one of these typewriters that has the dual keyboard. One keyboard is for lowercase and one is for uppercase. One keyboard is white colored keys, the other one is black colored keys. And the other interesting thing I found about this, and I've seen photos of these before, but she pointed it out so well in her piece, was that the keys are not staggered. It's like a grid. So if you notice, like on this typewriter, the keys are such that when you have two keys here, the one above it is in between two of the keys, like a conventional typewriter. But on the Smith Premier No. 4, the keys are literally in a grid. They're one above the other, an XY grid kind of thing. But I thought it was a really cool, interesting piece because I really learned something about it. Of course, it's a blind typer, meaning that you don't see the imprint. And so it's a challenge, I'm sure, to write on it. And of course, I really enjoyed seeing the writing from that machine. And it was really interesting. I really liked that piece, Diane. And I especially liked it because of this open assignment we had, that you could do something other than, you know, fiction or whatever, a story, that it's a quick start guide. Very good. I enjoyed it and I learned a lot. John Munro's piece was titled Slug to Pulp. What an interesting title. And he wrote it on his 1947 Royal Quiet Deluxe that he calls the Sweetheart of the Rodeo. Oh, yes. So this was a really nice piece, John. This was, I would call it an ode to the typewriting writer's life. As you call it in the piece, the slug life. The slug life. What a great phrase. What I like, a few things that you said in there. So first of all, it takes courage to first write the title down on an otherwise blank sheet of paper. I thought that was such a good point, because as you make the point, you would never do that on a computer, title the piece before you ever start it. What you say in there is that you strike that first letter and you are committed. What a great phrase. And so you also say that fortune favors the bold. Jump right in and make a mark. And that is so true with this kind of spontaneous, spur of the moment, stream of consciousness kind of writing. So important. And as you say, the muse, she doesn't take kindly to censorship. So this stage of writing is not the place to be striking things out and correcting things. You write down whatever you think, and you can edit later. What I liked about your piece also is you covered a lot of the aspects of creating on a typewriter as opposed to a computer. There's the technical difficulties that you spell out so well. You know, the skipping of the mechanical issues with a typewriter, perhaps, maybe ribbon issue, typographical errors. These are all little distractions that can move us away from, as you say, the rhythm of letters and words. And it is a hard place to do, to get into that zone. And also things like the lag between spelling a word in your mind as you're writing and the letters actually forming themselves via your fingers on paper. And sometimes I've seen this too, is I will misspell a word or get the letters jumbled around because I can think the word quicker than I can type it. It was a great synopsis of the typing writer, the typing writer's life, the slug life. Slug to pulp. Great job, John. And we have a new participant, Matthew Gilman. Welcome to the Typing Assignment series. And you wrote your piece on a Royal KMM. I at first couldn't quite make out legibly the title of your piece, but it's Haikikomori, a Japanese word, which according to Wikipedia means people who withdraw from all social life to an extreme degree of isolation and confinement. And that really explains your piece so well, once I was able to decipher the title and look up the meaning of the word. This is a really poignant piece. This is an expression of a very isolated person in the story named Charles. And Charles has severed all relationships, even his mother, to stay secluded in his apartment. He's even exhibiting these self-destructive tendencies, running out of food, not going to his job or not having a job or not wanting to answer the call of a job interview, ignoring his rent. Even at the end of the story, he picks up that rent check and heads to the door and then turns back. That was very poignant. Cutting off all your email. And the great line, I thought, in your piece that really illustrates this toward the end, it says, "The comfortable darkness that he called home." And that is so poignant. That really illustrates this hikikomori condition so well. Great job, Matthew, and welcome to the series. Andrew Nichols' piece was written on Hermes Baby, and it's called The Teacher from Hell. And maybe you've had a teacher like that, or maybe you've had a boss, a manager from hell. In his case, it was Mr. Jones, his French teacher, and a terrible person, a person who should never have been a teacher. And you illustrate this so clearly and so dramatically. When you say, "He certainly left his mark on me," in the introduction, that refers, I'm pretty sure, later in the piece where you say, "As his inner rage swelled, hit the kid then and there." Yeah, he probably left his physical mark on you, and I'm sorry to say. That's kind of the apex of the story. This abusive teacher finally blows up, crosses the line, and gets replaced at the end of the story with a new teacher in which we all got good grades and enjoyed French as well. So a happy ending, but nevertheless, there are those people in our lives, the people from hell, the teacher from hell. You know, it kind of reminds me, in my professional life, I've seen people ill fit for their job, as your teacher was, apparently. I hope you've healed from that experience, Andrew, but it was very illustrative reading it. Thank you very much for sharing. And Andy Kev's piece was written on a 1954 Smith Corona Silent, and it is called Conflagration. This is a real sobering story, and this is, although it is literally fictional for you, it is a very real account of the current fires burning in the wine country of Northern California as I read this. That are, and these unfortunate stories are all too real for so many thousands of people right now. Our heart goes out to them. But I think it's best if I simply read an excerpt from the email that Andy sent me, giving me a little bit of background on this story. This story is from the perspective of what happens if you were one of those people that your neighborhood was suddenly engulfed in this enormous firestorm and you barely got out with your lives and lost everything. And what Andy says is, "This is a terrible tragedy in the wine country. This will be worse than the Oakland Hills firestorm from 1991. And he says, "This story may serve to touch on what if. When a disaster happens, most of us are not prepared. And in a matter of hours, everything you worked for your whole life, everything in your home is gone. Records, tax forms, bank statements, birth certificates, everything else." And then he finishes, "What really matters is our lives and loved ones, our animals, not the stuff." That is so true. You know, we focus so much in our lives on the stuff, and it is so fragile. It is so easily lost, as we've seen this year in America and in other parts of the world with natural disasters happening and people's property and possessions and lives being lost so suddenly. Life is fragile, and we indeed must really consider what is most important in life. Thank you very much for that reminder, and we do think and pray about all those people in Northern California right now. Thanks a lot for the reminder, Andy. David Corneli's piece was written on a 1939 Erica Model 5, and it is called Homesick Angel. And it is about a B-17 bomber that is on display at Offutt Air Force Base in Nebraska. But this particular aircraft never actually saw combat in World War II. It's spent its time stateside, but it was named after another aircraft with the same moniker, which did serve in World War II and was shot down, and the crew captured and served as their time as POWs, prisoners of war. David makes a real interesting point about this. He wonders, because this typewriter that he's writing on, this Erica Model 5, was built in Dresden. And the factory, the typewriter factory in Dresden, was destroyed during the war by B-17 bombers. He really wonders what someone who was in Münster or Dresden during the war would perceive of this aircraft now being a monument to air power. And that's a really interesting question. Different sides of wars take different views about their machines and artifacts of war. So, very interesting piece. And they are a majestic aircraft, David, definitely. Thank you very much for your piece. Richard Wood wrote a really fun poem, and it was written on a Smith Corona GT, which I had to look up. I don't remember seeing one of those before. It's kind of an interesting looking, modernist looking typewriter. But his piece is titled My Smith Corona GT and Me. And the rhyming scheme in that title kind of gives you a clue as to the poem, which it is. And it is a really fun poem on the typewriter. He postulates on the possible legacy, what the typewriter could have been used for before he became the owner, and also on the joys of writing via typewriter. And it is such fun to write poetry or whatever, prose, on a typewriter. It really is. And there are so many good parts of this poem, it was hard for me to pick out just one part that I liked without quoting the whole poem. But I think the opening stanza really stands out to me, which is, "Its linkages, springs, hammers, and screws working together to reduce my blues." Isn't that true about typewriters with us typewriter lovers, huh? Good job, Richard. Thank you. And Dohang Michael Kitchen had a really interesting piece. So it was typed on a 1951 Royal Quiet Deluxe. And when I say it was typed on it, what I mean is he went to the Made in Michigan Festival, which is held in Mount Clemens, Michigan, and he was staffing or manning a table courtesy of two local businesses, Paperback Writer Books and Weirdsville Records. And he was staffing the table, but using his typewriter as kind of a draw or a hook to see if people would be attracted to it. And also, for him, it was kind of an experiment in public typing. And so he found lots of very good interaction with people because of his typewriter, which is interesting. I've experienced that also. He has several interesting things to say about it. He says, "Now this is kind of cool. It is pretty quiet out there on the street, and the clacking is extremely noticeable, almost singing out its own music." And then later on he says, "The sound of the typewriter is like the aroma of the popcorn vendor." Now, isn't that so true? It really is. This was a real fun piece because it was typed over a period of several hours and kind of a stream of consciousness as things happen, like if you were at a type-in and you wanted to document your experience as you were there on the typewriter. Very fun. I really enjoyed it, Michael. Thank you. Okay, this next piece is by Kevin Kittle, a local Albuquerquean who him and I had together went and saw California Typewriter, the movie, by the way. But Kevin wrote his piece. He composed it on an Olivetti Lettera 22 and finished the final copy on a Smith Corona SL575 electronic typewriter. And it's called Trashed BMW. And this is a very well-written story that I can certainly relate to. It's about one of those busy, hectic mornings in the city when people are trying to get to school, get to their job, and the trash trucks are driving around picking up the trash. The story is written from the perspective of two people. It alternates between the perspective of the trash truck driver driving around in his big truck, picking up the trash barrels and flipping them in and dropping them off, and this lady that is called BMW Lady, and she's always running late, and she has two kids she's trying to get to school, and she's texting or yakking on the phone, and she's distracted, and her and the trash truck are interacting in traffic. One is interfering with the other, and it's a classic busy, hectic morning. And the trash truck driver has to go back to get some gas. He's getting low on gas. The lady's trying to drop her kids off to the private school, and the story ends with a bad accident. The BMW is flipped over on the street. The kids are still suspended by their seatbelts inside. That was a really interesting story, Kevin, and I can definitely relate to it, seeing how the traffic can be in cities like ours. Well done. So this next piece is by a newcomer to our typing assignments, Ernest Steinbeck. Are you any relation to the other Steinbeck, Ernest, I wonder? His piece was written on a Smith Corona Coronet Automatic 12. I have one of those. Those are very cool electric typewriters, one of those hybrid electrified manual typewriters. But his piece is called Taxes, and it is a poem. And it is a surrealistic, and I would call it kind of a 1960s spirited poem, in that, to me, the imagery and the wordplay and everything kind of reminds me of underground comic strips, kind of like the Fabulous Furry Freak Brothers and that kind of stuff. I really got a sense of that in the poem. Really fun poem and some interesting imagery. And also, I don't know if this was purposeful or not, but the way you photographed your piece tilted. I cropped in a little bit just to make the words a little bit bigger for the video screen, but I thought the tilt of that photograph worked pretty well with the spirit of the poem. And welcome to the Typing Assignment series, Ernest. I really enjoyed your piece. Thank you very much. I really enjoyed the weirdness of this next piece so much, and there's so much about it that's funny. First of all, we don't really know who the person is, but they call themselves Scamperface. And so no real name and no indication of what typewriter was used to write it with or anything else. All we know is the piece appears to have a title, From the World's Leading Nobody, Dracula. But what it really is kind of a surrealistic prose piece. And it's essentially comprised of two letters, two brief notes, one written to an Augustine from a Bobby in Hollywood, and the other one is to a Leopold from an Igan or Egan. And then there's this little blurb of an advertisement, a fake advertisement at the bottom. Totally funny, totally surrealistic, and totally weird. And that is precisely what we love about typing assignments, especially an open subject typing assignment where you don't know what you're going to get. This was fantastically funny and I really enjoyed it. And I wonder, you know, of course, I keep trying to read into some of this, you know, like, Augustine and Leopold. Okay, there's some historical characters there. You know, and you start thinking, okay, maybe there's more to this than it really looks on the surface. Maybe there's a lot of symbolism in it, more than just mere surrealism or even random stuff. But nevertheless, I really enjoyed it, and that must have been a lot of fun to write, whoever Scamperface is out there. Thank you for participating. So we've had some interesting poems, interesting prose pieces, very unique and original in this open assignment. This next one is just the same. This is from Diane Cox. It was written and you could say drawn also on a Hermes 3000. And it's called I Wish I Were My Cat, indeed. And what this is a poem and a piece of typewriter art. I think this is maybe the first typewriter art that we've had in this series, and I loved it. And I love your little cat sitting below your typing desk as you're tap, tap, tapping away. Indeed, we sometimes do wish we were our pets. They live, some of them, a pretty cozy life, huh? And I really loved your piece, Diane. Well done. Paul Hopper is another newcomer to our typing assignment series. He wrote his piece on a Brother Charger 11, which I have one of those right down on the floor over there. His piece is a great essay. It is an essay on how digital saved analog. And he has a really interesting argument here. First of all, he talks about how he used to be a film photographer years ago, but he obviously became a digital photographer, but his digital camera broke. And not wanting to spend $800 or $1,000 on a new digital camera, he just pulled out his old film camera and looked up and found out that the place that he used to get his film developed from was still in business, and he started shooting film again, and he loved it. He rediscovered it. And he talks about some of these rediscoveries of old technologies, what we call generically analog technologies. Like, for instance, there is a podcast called The Film Photography Project, which discusses using old film cameras and shooting film and all that. There is The Impossible Project, which was a group in the Netherlands that bought an old shut down Polaroid film factory and restarted the manufacture of new Polaroid compatible film, and have been successful enough now that they've bought the rights to use the Polaroid name on their film. And the Lomography Group, which is a group of students originally out of Vienna, Austria, who discovered these quirky little Russian-made Lomo LCA cameras, and it sort of started the whole modern movement of toy cameras and plastic cameras and kind of low-tech film cameras that have a different look to them. What he says about it is really interesting. He says at the end, ironic then is the fact that what was supposed to totally replace analog technology ended up saving it from extinction. And I think what he means by this is that people have rediscovered, you know, vinyl records, audio tape, typewriters, film, because of the internet, because of digital technology. These older forms of technology have a second life. And that is so true, Paul. Great thoughts and a great piece, and welcome to the Typing Assignment series. And Ira Stone wrote his piece on a royal epic, and his piece is titled The Consolation of Obituaries. This was really fun, Ira. You really did well on this. He starts out talking about this documentary called Obit, which is about the New York Times obituary writer and what that whole world is like. But for Ira himself, he has personally been an avid reader and collector of obituaries and death notices over the years. And for him, in the last few years, maybe the last year or so, obituaries and death notices have been a welcome respite from all the other stuff going on in the news of political and natural calamities and going on. And he even says that all that curdles his tea as he drinks his tea in the morning. But for him, the obituaries and death notices have become a real lifeline of entertainment. And what he says about it is really funny. He says, "What a pleasant and peaceful world emerges from the words of the obituary. Black and white, Christian, Muslim, or Jew, foreign and domestic, everyone gets along side by side on the last page of Section A of the New York Times. And my tea tastes as wonderful as ever." That's really good. And what I really loved about it is how he describes how much the obituaries are written to elevate the status of the person, and it makes it sound as if everybody dies an idyllic death with everybody at the bedside, no pain, no discomfort. Even the ex-wives are there, we could assume, right? So it is funny how obituaries are written. And I was really entertained by that, Ira. Thank you very much. Alex Lopatka sent his piece just at the last minute while I was busy shooting the scenes for this video, but he got his story in under the wire, and what a great story it was, because I can relate to this. It's a true story, a true accounting of when he was a younger man, him and another person, another boy, discovered these big concrete storm drain pipes, big enough to go into. And him and his buddy go into the pipe and go under the street and go up the street, and it gets smaller and smaller and tighter, and finally they get so tight that they would have to be crawling on their stomachs to get through it, and they decide, they find a manhole, and they were able to push the manhole cover up and exit out of the storm drain, much to the surprise of some kids playing in their yard across the street. to see a manhole cover in the middle of the street be pushed up and three boys come out of it. Now, the reason why I like your story so well, not only is it true and not only was it well written, but when I was a teenager in high school, we did the very same thing. I remember we would go into those storm drains, roughly four foot diameter concrete tubes, and they would go up underneath the street. And I remember one of them, we went into about a half mile underneath the street following this big pipe. And I only think nowadays, years later, in the summertime when we have flash floods in Albuquerque because of the rains up in the Sandia Mountains, those storm drains can suddenly fill with water. And we were just foolish enough to go do that and not get hurt. But that was a very fun story, Alex. Thank you, and welcome to the Typing Assignment series. And finally was a piece I wrote a week or so ago, back in October 9th, I wrote it. Okay, so the backstory to this little piece of fiction is, which is titled, The Strip Mall Jesus and First Church of Perpetual Video. And so what that's all about, as I wrote in my blog, is I have these dreams. I've had episodic dreams over the years. It's the same or similar kinds of settings, and they recur periodically. And it's like a story that is kind of ongoing, a serial story that you periodically revisit, and it continues. And I have a number of several of these different serial dream series that go on. And this one was kind of based on, the setting was a little TV repair shop that I used to work at. It was a narrow little shop, but in the dream, the wall has been broken out into the next space. It was a lot of clutter, kind of like the way TV repair shops are or were. The main character was sort of like my boss who used to own the shop. And when I woke from my dream, and that's the best time, by the way, to do writing, is when you're just woken from your dream and your mind is most creative. I had this idea, wow, this would make an interesting story. So I sat down and kind of wrote this story, The Strip Mall Jesus and First Church of Perpetual Video. I really had fun with this, and I'm glad that I could do this. I'm glad we have the opportunity to have an open assignment kind of a session here where we could write anything at all that we wanted to. And this reminds me that the work you guys submitted this time, so well done. It's such a wide variety of stuff, from surrealistic poems and essays and true-to-life accounts, even typewriter art. How great is that? I think that was just fantastic. And so I will be submitting the assignment for Typing Assignment 11 coming up in the next day or so. So stay tuned for that. And until next time, this is Jovan Cleave. Please be kind and rewind. And until later, you have yourselves a great day.